Welcome and thank you for joining us this morning. I hope you've had a good week. We are living in difficult times, but there are many blessings. The blessing of being with family and those we love. This is the third part in our series, Big Questions, and thank you for joining us. If you are feeling discouraged this morning, my prayer is that God will speak to your heart this morning, and may we sense His peace and presence. May we be blessed and inspired this morning as we consider God's Word. Our reading this morning is taken from Psalm 119, and our reading will be taken by Jim.
This morning's reading is Psalm 119, starting at verse 97 through to verse 112. Oh, how I love your law! It is my meditation all the day. You, through your commandments, make me wiser than my enemies, for they are ever with me. I have more understanding than all my teachers, for your testimonies are my meditation. I understand more than the ancients, because I keep your precepts. I have restrained my feet from every evil way, that I may keep your word. I have not departed from your judgments, for you yourself have taught me. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Through your precepts I get understanding. Therefore, I hate every false way. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn and confirmed that I will keep your righteous judgments. I am afflicted very much. Revive me, O Lord, according to your word. Accept, I pray, the freewill offerings of my mouth, O Lord, and teach me your judgments. My life is continually in my hand, yet I do not forget your law. The wicked have laid a snare for me, yet I have not strayed from your precepts. Your testimonies I have taken as a heritage forever, for they are the rejoicing of my heart. I have inclined my heart to perform your statutes forever, to the very end.
We've encouraged our fellowship to join us in taking a reading, and that is such a blessing. So thank you so much, Jim, for that reading this morning. Let us bow our heads together and let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity we have of coming before you. You are the Creator of heaven and earth, and we thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. We praise you and we worship you this morning. You are above all, and we thank you, Lord, that we can come before you. Thank you, Lord, that you hear our prayers. Thank you, Lord, that you answer our prayers according to your will. We come before you, Lord, this morning, and we thank you for this day. We thank you for the privilege we have of hearing your word this morning. We know we are living in difficult times and difficult circumstances, and we pray for those who are really feeling distressed at this time. We pray for those who've lost loved ones and families who are going through times of anxiety and fear. And we pray that your peace that passes all understanding will be with people at this time. But Lord, we pray that in this time of distress, in this time of struggle, that many will turn to you. We know, Lord, that you are the only hope that we have. And that is our prayer, that through this difficult time, that as you are working in the hearts and lives of people, that people will turn to you, the only one true God, the Creator of heaven and earth. We thank you, Lord, for the blessing we have seen in the way in which people have come together, which is good, in what's been happening within communities. And we just pray that that will help us as the church to really encourage others and bless others and be those who have a very positive testimony within our community and within where we live. We commit ourselves to you, Lord, this morning, and we pray that you'll be with us. We pray that you'll be with those who are feeling vulnerable and isolated. We pray that they will reach out and that we will be able to see how we can help as your people. We know it's a very difficult time, Lord, but thank you, Lord, for the hope that we have in you. Thank you that you promise to never leave us. You are there with us in the midst of what we are facing. Lord, we pray for our fellowship. We pray that you will be with us as a church. We pray for everyone in our church. We pray also for those that we are ministering to far wider than just the four walls of our church. And we pray that as we consider your word, Lord, that you will truly speak to our hearts this morning. Thank you, Lord, for who you are. Thank you that we can trust you. And Lord, please be with us when we are feeling anxious or distressed. Thank you, Lord, that we know that in you we have salvation. In you we have a hope beyond this world. Help us to set our minds on things above. Help us not to look at that which is seen, but that which is not seen. And help us to hold on to you, because we know that you hold on to us. As we commit ourselves to you, Lord, this morning, we pray that we will grow together in grace, that we will grow in faith, and that we will grow in the knowledge of who you are. As we commit ourselves to you, Lord, this morning, we thank you that you are with us. In your wonderful name we pray, the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Our first song this morning is, O God of Highest Heaven. I just read the first two lines. O great God of Highest Heaven, occupy my lowly heart, own it all and reign supreme, conquer every rebel power. May you be blessed by the song this morning. As a church, we celebrate Holy Communion on the first Sunday of every month. Now, we know that these circumstances are difficult. We can't gather together. But I felt it would be important for us just to remember what our Lord has done for us. We know that the emblems speak to us of our Lord's body that was broken for us and his blood that was shed. The scriptures declare in that night in which our Lord was betrayed, He took bread and he broke it and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you." In like manner, our Lord took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the New Testament in my blood. Drink ye all of it in remembrance of me." Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your abounding love, grace and mercy to us. We thank you for the salvation that is in our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father, for sending the Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, to this world. We thank you, Lord, for willingly making that sacrifice, that your body was broken for us and your blood was shed. Thank you for that perfect, complete sacrifice. Thank you, Lord, for paying that price for us and purchasing our salvation. We are very grateful, Lord, and we pray that you will help us to offer up our lives as a living sacrifice to you. Help us to keep at the forefront of our thinking what you have done for us. Help us daily to be reminded of your sacrifice, that we will also sacrifice in like manner for you and for your honor and glory. Lord, we know we are living in difficult circumstances, Lord, and we pray that despite the challenges we face, despite the fact that we can't gather together as your people, we pray that you will still encourage us and help us to know that you are with us and in you we are united. And we thank you just for this brief moment in which we can reflect upon the emblems and your body that was broken for us and your blood that was shed. In your wonderful name we pray, the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. We continue with our series entitled Big Questions. And the question we are considering this morning is, can I trust the Bible? I take two readings this morning. The first is from 2 Timothy chapter 3, reading verse 16 to 17. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. The second reading is taken from Hebrews chapter 4, reading verse 12. For the word of God is living and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. The Christian faith rests on the Bible. The Bible is our authority in all matters of faith. As Christians, we need to have an absolute assurance that the Bible is the Word of God. Now, there are many books in the world, but none of them claim to be the Word of God. Even within religion, there are many writings, but none of those writings claim to be the ultimate authority as the Bible does. All our trust is vested in the Bible, in its inspiration and also in its inerrancy. Inspiration is very important. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, we read that all scripture is inspired by God. That basically God breathed the scriptures through the authors. As the authors wrote, God inspired them to write. So from Genesis to Revelation, every part of scripture is inspired by God. But we also believe that the Bible is inerrant. It is without fault. It is perfect. It is right. It is true. Every part of it from Genesis to Revelation. The Bible is inspired and the Bible is inerrant. Without both inspiration and inerrancy, we would have no message, no gospel, and no hope. But the Bible has faced many attacks. Those attacks have been physical, where people have tried to destroy the Bible. Other attacks have been more subtle in trying to undermine the Bible. It all started in Genesis chapter 3 when the serpent said to Eve, "Has God really said?" The serpent undermined God's word by casting doubt upon what God had said. There have been many attacks on the Bible throughout the centuries, from outside the church and also from within the church. From without the church, we've seen atheism attacking the Bible very aggressively. And we've seen that with the rise of the internet and social media, that a lot of misinformation can be sent out and cast doubt upon the Bible. So atheism has had a real strategic, aggressive attack on the Bible. But there's also been a far more subtle attack. And within the world we're living in now, currently, the postmodern view is what people subscribe to, that truth cannot be known. And that is an attack on the Bible. So when the Bible says it is truth, and when we as Christians declare the Bible to be God's word and truth, many will say, but truth cannot really be known. How can you say that? That's from without, outside the church. But what's happened within? From within the church, we've had liberalism. And liberalism is basically the undermining of the authority of Scripture, where certain things can be believed and other things cannot be believed. And the liberal side to Christianity has said some things are true, others are not. And that's very dangerous. And at the forefront of that was a man called Friedrich Schleiermacher, who undermined the authority of Scripture. And many have followed him within the church to say, well, some things are just stories, they're not really true. And that's a very dangerous way of reading the Bible, because it's not what the Bible claims of itself. Also within the church, experiential Christianity has been dangerous. And experiential Christianity is the focus on subjective experience as the basis for truth. But the Bible is truth. The Bible is our authority. Therefore, it's important to know that experience is determined by truth and not truth by experience. So the Bible is the authority, and every other experience we have is only based upon what God's word declares and affirmed by God's word. And unfortunately, experiential Christianity has led people away from the word as the authority and has based all the authority on experience. Mark Twain said the following: "The Bible is full of interest. It has noble poetry in it, some clever fables, some blood-drenched history, some good morals, a wealth of obscenity, and upwards of 1,000 lies." Dwight Moody said, "The Bible is not given for information, but for transformation." Without Christ, without the resurrection, and without the Bible, we have no Christianity. And therefore the question, "Can I trust the Bible?" is a very important question, and one that we need to consider. Firstly, as we ask the question, "Can I trust the Bible?" we have to look at the evidence. We have to ask, is the Bible reliable? And is the Bible true? Is the Bible reliable as a historical, accurate document? And is it also truthful? Is what is in the Bible true? And I believe that the Bible gives us evidence, and history gives us evidence to believe that the Bible is both reliable and true. But let's look at manuscript evidence. Ancient documents continue through copies. A copy is a handwritten copy of a document. That is how ancient literature gets carried forward, because there wasn't a printing press. So you would have scribes and people sitting down and meticulously writing down copies of historical documents. So many people say, but where are the originals of the Bible? You don't have originals of many documents. And the reason for this is because ancient documents could not survive, because the paper would perish. And therefore, the way that you trace a document is on the amount of handwritten copies that are available. Now, when it comes to handwritten copies and the credibility of a document, there is no greater credibility than the Bible. The Bible has more than 24,000 handwritten copies of the originals. That is more than any other historical document in history by far. And therefore we can trust that the Bible is reliable because those handwritten copies can be traced and followed. Also, another aspect to if a document is reliable is how close those copies are to the originals, and also how close the originals are to the events. So we see that the Bible has 24,000 copies, but we also see that the Bible is written within the New Testament, especially within 50 years of the events taking place. Therefore, from a reliability perspective, the Bible is more reliable than any other document based upon the copies and based upon how close it was written to the original events. But also we see not just the manuscript evidence, which is there, but we also see that the Bible is accurate on events, that there's an accuracy of events in the Bible. The Bible is historically accurate. And that is very, very important. So when we read the scriptures, we read of the people and the places and the events of history and what happened, we see that the Bible flows with history and is historically accurate to those events. Also, we see that the Bible is accurate according to archaeology and science, that there are places and people and coins and civilizations that the Bible mentions who all existed and have been traced throughout history and found through either archaeology or other means. Archaeology has also proven the Bible. And especially one example is the Hittites. As we know with David, that he committed adultery with Bathsheba and murdered her husband Uriah the Hittite. Now for many years people believed that the Bible wasn't true because the Hittites could never be found, they didn't exist. And in the earlier 20th century, there was an excavation where they found the whole Hittite civilization and evidence of the Hittites. There we go. Archaeology proves the Bible. But also science. Science walks hand in hand with the Bible. The Bible's not against science, and I don't believe that true science is against the Bible. They walk hand in hand. So scientifically and archaeologically, the Bible is as evidence to be true. But then also we see that more evidence to the Bible is prophecy. When we look historically at the Old Testament and then looking back at history, we see that many things that the prophets spoke about were things that we can trace back in history. It wasn't just relating to a dynamic within, let's say, Israel, but there are things that the prophets speak about, places and events that came true before. And those were written before these events, especially as we look at the book of Daniel, where Daniel speaks about certain empires and kingdoms that will follow him and where he is in Babylon at the time. And those things came to pass. We know that the book of Daniel was written more than 500 years before Christ. And yet we see clearly that the events that followed came to pass. Even the Greeks, who happened about 150 years later or 200 years later, then you also had the Roman Empire, all of these things. So prophecies in the Old Testament relating to people have come true, but also prophecies relating to the person of Christ. There were more than 300 prophecies about the Lord Jesus Christ who all came true. So when we look at the Bible from a reliability perspective and a truth perspective, we see that there is more than enough evidence to convince any critic that the Bible is reliable and the Bible is true and also trustworthy. Now, there's a lot of information out there about the evidence to the Bible, and it really is fascinating when that is looked through, and there is so much evidence to the Bible. But what does the Bible say about itself? Because it's not just the evidence that helps us to trust the Bible. That's there. But also, what does the Bible say about itself? Because the Bible says that it is truth and it is God's word. Now, for me personally, I would want someone to either accept that or reject that. That's their decision to make. Either accept or reject. But the difficulty is when people try and change what it's saying. They'll be trying to say that the Bible is saying something different from what it's actually saying. What does the Bible say about itself? Let's look at the Old Testament. In Psalm 33, verse 4, it says, God's word is right. Proverbs 30, verse 5, God's word is pure. Psalm 119, verse 160. God's word is truth. So in the Old Testament, we see clearly through these declarations, the Bible is right, the Bible is pure, the Bible is truth. The Bible is God's word. In the New Testament, in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23, the Bible lives and abides forever. So God's word lives and abides forever. 2 Timothy 3:16, which we read, that all scripture is given by God. Ephesians 6, verse 17, the word is a sword. The word is a sword. So we see that the Bible endures forever and abides forever. All scripture is given by God, and the word is a sword. Jesus also said the following, because it is important. What did Jesus say about the Bible? The Old Testament says it's right and pure and truth. New Testament, it abides forever. It's given by God. It's a sword. But what does Jesus say about the Bible? In Matthew 5, verse 18, Jesus said that all scripture will be fulfilled. In Mark 7, verse 13, it says the Bible is the word of God. And then in John 17, verse 17, God's word is truth. Jesus also said that the word and the word of God, the scriptures testify of him. So Jesus Christ had very clear dynamic in what he was saying, that the Bible, the scriptures, it is the word of God and needs to be seen as such. Also, Jesus Christ spoke of Adam and Eve, and he spoke of Adam and Eve and gave authority to Genesis, speaking about Adam and Eve. He spoke about Abel. He spoke about Noah. He spoke about Abraham. He spoke about Sodom. He spoke about Lot and Isaac and Jonah. So we see the Old Testament makes the clear declaration that it is truth, the New Testament that it's truth, and Jesus confirms that the Bible is the truth, and everything the Old Testament speaks of is truth because Jesus spoke on that authority. And that is why it is so important for us to know what the Bible says about itself. And that is why people struggle with the Bible. It's not because of what it's saying on a superficial level, but it's what it's truly saying, that the Bible is God's word. And the Bible clearly claims to be God's word. And that is what it says about itself. But let's also look at the unity of the Bible. Because when we ask the question, can I trust the Bible? I believe the unity of the Bible is a great evidence to the fact that the Bible is trustworthy. Because the unity of the Bible is a reason to trust it. So let's look at the unity. We had 40 authors. The Bible was written by 40 different authors. Over a 1,500-year period. Over three continents and three languages. So let's just try and soak that in. So 40 authors, 1,500 years, three continents and three languages, and yet there is absolute unity from Genesis to Revelation. We see unity relating to God in his character and nature and who he is. Throughout the scriptures, that clear unity of God, the clear aspect of God's triune nature as a Trinity is there, his righteousness, his holiness, his love, his grace, his mercy. It flows from Genesis to Revelation. There's complete unity at who God is. There's also unity with man, his nature and his heart. And Jeremiah 17 verse 9 says that the heart of man is wicked. And we see that flow throughout scripture, that man is in sin and man is fallen and man falls short of God. And his nature is not that which searches for righteousness or wanting to do what is good, but he is wicked and he falls short. And we see that in our world. That unity is there from the fall in Genesis chapter 3 right through. We see clearly who man truly is and his need for redemption. That's throughout the scriptures. Also, we see salvation. That there's a unity in the Bible of what salvation is. And how God saves his people in God's provision and also in sacrifice. We see that throughout scripture, that God gives, and what does he give? He gives sacrifice. And that sacrifice is that the innocent must die for the guilty. We see that throughout the scriptures. A very important part to that was with Abraham and Isaac, when God said to Abraham, take Isaac and sacrifice Isaac. And we see that when Abram was about to sacrifice Isaac, that God gave a ram. That he said, don't sacrifice your son, there's the ram. And what's so beautiful about that is when Abraham and Isaac looked at the ram, they saw Jehovah Jireh, the Lord our provider. So we see the principle of salvation throughout the scriptures is God providing salvation. Jehovah Jireh, the one who provides. So we see a unity with God, with man, and salvation. But then we also see a unity in the Gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And what I love about the Gospels is the fact that it's not 100% exactly the same. And what I mean by that is it flows beautifully, it's perfect in unison, and it tells exactly the same events and has the same dynamic of who Christ is, but it's told from different aspects. It's told from Matthew's perspective, from Mark's perspective, from Luke's perspective, and from John's perspective. All four Gospels focus on different aspects to the person of Christ. Matthew looks at him as king. Mark considers him as a servant. Luke highlights his humanity and taking on that human flesh. And then, of course, John focuses on the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's perfect unity, but different. If the Bible was contrived and people got together to try and write this devious book, you would not have the four Gospels, because people would have sat down and wrote exactly the same thing, and all four Gospels would have said exactly the same thing on exactly the same events. But what we see are different angles to the same event, and there's such a beautiful unity in the Gospels, which to me helps me to see the unity in the scriptures and in the Bible, but to also have confidence in what God has declared and how we see God inspiring the authors. So he uses their personalities and their frame of reference and their perspective to breathe life into the scriptures. And we see that in the Gospels. So it's clear within the Bible that we see this flow of unity in the scriptures, which helps us to trust the Bible as a reliable document and also a document that is truth. And then finally, what is the power of the Bible? I take a reading from Hebrews chapter 1, reading verse 1 to 2. God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds. What is the power of the Bible? The power of the Bible is the fact that God has spoken. That when we hold the Bible in our hands, that what we know is that God has spoken in his word. And that is powerful, because it is God, the creator of heaven and earth, who has spoken to us. When we look at the history of the Bible, we see its survival, and it's absolutely amazing. 200 years before Christ, Antiochus Epiphanes tried to destroy every single Old Testament he could find. It survived. Within the last 2,000 years, we've seen throughout history many trying to destroy the Bible, yet it survives. Why? Because it is God's Word, and the power of God's Word is there. It is a miracle how we hold the Bible in our hands. The Bible is God's Word, and it changes lives. So why do I trust the Bible? I trust the Bible because it's changed my life. So yes, that is experiential, but it is what the Bible says it does. It says it changes lives. In Romans chapter 10, verse 17, it says the following. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I can testify personally to that power. That when I came to know Christ, the verse that was very clear in my heart and in my mind was the passage in Philippians chapter 2, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. The Bible changes lives. And faith comes by hearing, and hearing from the Word of God. Hebrews chapter 4 also says, as we read earlier on, that the Word of God is alive and it cuts to the heart. It really cuts to at the inside of us, because it is the power of God. It is alive. It is God's revelation. It's how God has revealed himself. And how powerful is that to know that the creator of heaven and earth has revealed himself in his word? The Bible is God's revelation, but it's also not just his revelation, but it's also his declaration. The Bible declares to us who God is. It also declares to us who we are. And the Bible also declares to us how we truly can be reconciled to God. The Bible is the power of God. And it is, we've seen how the Bible has changed the lives of people throughout history. Therefore, as Christians, it is of absolute importance for us to declare the authority of the Bible in our lives and also in the life of the church. Charles Spurgeon said, "The word of God is like a lion. You don't have to defend a lion. All you have to do is let it loose, and the lion will defend itself." And that is why we as Christians don't have to defend the Bible. The Bible defends itself. But it's important for us as Christians to be confident in the scriptures ourselves, to be confident in what it says, to be confident in its power. How are we going to reach the world? We're not going to reach them through programs and doing things on a social level. We are going to reach the world by declaring the word of God, because when we declare the word of God, like the lion, we just release the lion and it will do its work. Now, there are difficult things in the Bible. And we have to be honest about it. There are difficult things. There are difficult events that have taken place that's difficult for us to explain. And sometimes, even from a scientific perspective, it is difficult. Why? Because the Bible is filled with miracles. And miracles cannot always be explained. But I believe when we look at the scriptures, there is more than enough evidence outside of miracles to help us to know the miracles are true, because everything else is true. So when we look at the scriptures, yes, there are things that some people will doubt and be concerned about and really question. And that's okay for them to question. It's part of how God works. That questioning is part of it. But what is so important is that the Bible is reliable and we can trust it. Because with the creator of heaven and earth, miracles are easy. The creator wrote the Bible. He inspired the Bible. Therefore, everything that happens in it, it's easy for him. It's not difficult. But as Hebrews 11 says, that we must believe that God is, and that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So do we believe that the creator of heaven and earth inspired the word? Because I believe God has given us enough to believe in the Bible. Do you believe in the Bible? That is the question. Do we believe in the Bible? Do we believe the Bible is God's word and the ultimate authority? Can we trust it as a document? I believe that's easy. Yes, we can. We can trust the Bible as a historical document. But there's more to that. It's not about trusting the Bible just as a historical document. It's about trusting it as God's word. Do we believe it is God's word? And do we believe it is authoritative? Is it the authority in the life of the church? Is it the authority in the life of a believer? Because I believe we can trust the Bible, but I believe it needs to be the authority in our lives. As Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds from God. We need to live and breathe the word of God. It needs to be everything in our lives, because it is the authority. If we want to know how to live life, if we want to know how to deal with life, if we want to know how to manage and navigate the world we're living in, the Bible is our source. It has everything we need. It is 100% sufficient on all areas in the Christian life. Do we trust that? So as we answer the question, can I trust the Bible? I believe we can. Yes, we can trust the Bible with absolute confidence and with full assurance that it is the Word of God. May we live out that confidence. May we declare the confidence we have in God's word, because we know that God's word is true. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your revelation. We thank you for your declaration. We thank you for your grace and mercy to us. Thank you, Lord, that we can with full assurance this morning say that we believe in your word and your word is truth. Thank you for the Bible. Thank you for the way in which you've worked throughout history to preserve your word. Thank you for the blessing we have of holding your word in our hands. Thank you for inspiring all the men and women to make sure that they fight through to keep your word. Thank you for that, Lord. Help us, Lord, in our lives to hold your word up high, that your word will be our authority in everything that we do. Help us to declare your word to others. Help us to hold on to your word, that it will govern everything we do and say and how we live. Thank you, Lord, for your word. And Lord, help us to be confident in sharing your word, because there are many skeptics. There are many people who don't believe. Help us to not have to feel consistently we have to defend your word, but help us just to share it and release it so that others can experience it, its true power to bring about a life change. Thank you, Lord, for the fact that your word renews us and makes us new daily. Help us to live in your word, to love your word, and to declare your word. We thank you, Lord, for your grace and mercy in our lives as we commit ourselves to you. In your wonderful name we pray, the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Thank you for joining us, and please join us again next week as we consider the fourth part in our series, Big Questions, and we ask the question, is there life after death? Our final song for this morning is The Perfect Wisdom of Our God. May you be blessed. Thank you and see you next week. Say.
dwell in your perfect way. Each strand of sorrow has a place within this tapestry of grace. So through the trials I choose to say, your perfect will in your perfect way.